My name is Kash Pichale, and I would like to welcome you to my talk about web APIs that developers love. Who of you had been listening to the talk before? All right, that's very good. Because actually, I haven't spoken to Oliver before, but fortunately, we do not share much in our presentation, so at the end there were some questions that I will cover, so that is very good. I know that you already know REST, and there have been thousands of talks and presentations about that, so don't be afraid, I won't cover that. I won't explain the very basics of REST and HTTP, and I won't bother you with the basic difference between remote procedure calls and how to use correctly resources. There are a lot of best practices out there that are well known, agreed, but I will skip them today. Not because they are not important, it's just because I have only 45 minutes time, and I would like to concentrate on other aspects that are also important and hopefully interesting for you. I did decide to give this talk this title. It's obviously catchy, but I think it's also adequate because that is what APIs are all about. They have to be optimized for developers, not for machines. And this perspective is very important, and I would like to start explaining this. On a very high level, you have this scenario. There's a client that uses the implementation of a component or a service, and it's done through the API. This is the external visible operations with input and output, and this is the kind of contract that is made between the client and that component or that service. That's clear, I think. So, and of course, there is no contract between the client and the implementation, which brings us the decoupling from the implementation. So that could be changed or could have a completely different stack. And there's another function that is integration and reuse, because that API that the client is using is optimized for this purpose. It's optimized for integration and reuse. That means we have different quality attributes for API and our implementation. The implementation is probably optimized for performance, for maintainability, testability, and so many other quality attributes. But API, this is something else. It should be easy to understand, easy to use, easy to learn, and many other similar attributes. So therefore, there's another function that is sometimes forgotten, or it's not that obvious. And this is communication among developers. Because whenever there's a piece of code that should be reused by another team or by another developer, and the original developer is not at hand to ask and explain how this could be used, there's a communication problem. And of course, the solution is the API itself. So the API becomes a communication channel, and that's why we have to optimize APIs for this purpose. So APIs, again, are intended for developers, not for machines. It's for people. If you are using in the web or on the web standard HTTP, if you are comply to the REST principles, it helps a lot. But I think it's also important to provide documentation that is accurate, that has enough information and brings examples, because usually developers learn very well with examples. But I don't want to stress this more than this. I would like to take this developer perspective and come to the next topic, which is UI design. Oliver before spoke about domain-driven design and how this can be used to identify the resources and their aggregates, root aggregates. This is a completely different topic. I concentrate now on the UI design, which is also very important for web APIs, web API design. And I'm not saying REST APIs, I'm saying in more general web APIs. So a UI is, of course, a unique identifier for a resource. You know that. And you have an example, which is, can you see that? Yes. Answers 42. And I'm sure you know which answer I mean. It's the answer to life, the universe, and everything. So this brings us to this book. But on the other side, such an UI could be very cryptic and has the same function. It uniquely identifies a resource. Which one is better depends on the use case. This is readable. We have an intuitive understanding that this book or this answer that is written about in this book is meant. And this is very cryptic. We have no idea what it is. Maybe for a machine it makes sense, but not for a human reader. Nonetheless, the client should never create the links by himself. This is a task for the server. The server provides the links. This is a basic concept of hypermedia and REST. When we look at this example, this is JSON, a small JSON document with an array of links. In this case, it's just one link inside. And there's a hyperreference, a relation, and a method. The method is GET, of course. This is the HTTP operation that is used to call that link. There's a relation that explains the semantic. There's a long list of standard relation types that should be reused if possible. If that's not enough, you can define your own, and you have to define that this is part of the API contract. And there is this hyperreference, this UI. So, and without knowing anything about this API, we can see it's an API from PayPal, and it's a Sandbox installation. It's version 1. And here's a payment, and there is this, it's obviously an ID because it starts with pay minus 2x and so on. So this obviously identifies a unique payment, and this and maybe other resources are put together in this group of other resources that are called payments. So without any documentation, without knowing anything about this API, we just see this link and we can read it, we can understand it. It's intended to be used by a client, I mean a machine in this case. But at the beginning, if we want to learn and explore such an API, this helps a lot when we can read the UIs. So, and then again, what is the question? The question is, should we care about UI design? No, from a pure REST point, it's not necessary. The links, the UIs are provided, we just use them. But then again, why not? It's no contradiction. There are many APIs that aren't really RESTful. And readable UIs help us a lot, help us as developers to understand and use the API. What are the advantages of UI design? Well, we can read the UI and guess what the nature is all about this. When we look at this, we see it's part of the GitHub API. There's a resource, collection resource called users. And this is probably the name or the ID of a specific user. And his followers, a sub-resource. And now we can read that this UI identifies the followers of the user Mojombo. So it's very easy to make it readable. Hackable, this is not necessary for REST, but it helps a lot. Because if we remove this character Mojombo followers, we can go directly to users and we expect to get a list of users, which is actually the case. Or we can navigate directly to another user by replacing Mojombo with another ID. And it works. So this is very nice to get to know an API, to experiment with it, and to learn it. And of course, proper UI design helps us to make stable links or UIs, to avoid broken links, to avoid broken bookmarks. And if there's really a good reason for removing or moving links, resources, then you should answer this with a proper status code. What's more about UIs? I said they should be readable, and they become very readable when they're short. Of course, they should be as short as possible, but not shorter. That means using abbreviation could be counterproductive. So don't make them shorter as they should be. Be consistent, identify patterns that you want to use, identify names, and stick to them. Don't use synonyms for the same concept, which when it's not necessary. And decide for a case and stick to it. Typically, plural nouns are used and recommended. Strict lowercase is my favorite. And if you use strict lowercase, you cannot use camel case anymore, but sometimes you need a kind of separator for different words to make it more readable, then just use hyphen, because there's seldom a problem with hyphens in UIs. What's about pseudo file endings? We find them in the internet a lot. There's, for instance, and this is almost a joke, this URL or this UI identifies the dissertation from Roy Fielding, who wrote initially about REST. And of course, this has had to have a pseudo file ending, because it's a file in a web app, but actually there is no real technical reason for that. But then again, there are also quite modern APIs. We see here the Twitter API, and they again use pseudo file endings. I'm sure they know what they did, hopefully. But there's a good reason, I think. They have been very practical, because they just they support only JSON and XML, and there is no content negotiation. Just JSON and XML. So if we replace this ending JSON with XML, we get another representation of that user. And this could be, this is not pretty, this is not REST, but it's practical, because if you put this URI into an email and send it to a colleague, he will get the same representation, the same object, without any other additional headers and so on. So this is practical. What's about trailing slashes? There is a similarity in the semantics between the Unix file paths and the UIs. If I'm not mistaken, this identifies a Unix file, and if I use a trailing slash, I have a directory, right? The same should be true for UIs, but let's look at this. First of all, we have our books again, and it's a collection of books, because this identifies a list of books, and it makes sense to use a trailing slash, because it's similar to a directory, yeah? Because it's a collection of more things. Okay, it works. If we identify a single book, we have no trailing slash, because it's a single book and we have a single file without trailing slash, makes sense in a way. But then again, what's now? This book could have chapters, and the chapters could have a single chapter, so this is obviously broken. And therefore, I recommend using no trailing slashes at all, be consistent, and use them just where they are necessary to separate these parts, but not at the end. That's very easy. Another thing about trailing slashes, sometimes you find in a hypermedia API a kind of directory resource that is the first resource in your UI, and it provides the first links to start the navigation, to start the conversation with UI. And if you do this, try to avoid making this. I made this mistake once, and that's why I created this slide. Yeah? Don't remember removing the trailing slash. What's about relations? These are also important for proper UI design. Usually, the UI design follows this pattern, which is a hierarchical, and it's very easy and effective. We start with a collection, and this has an item. There's a sub-collection with sub-items, and there could probably a sub-sub-collection with sub-sub-items, and so on. So it's very handy to model one-to-one and one-to-many relations. Yeah? And we could create a person that is part of this group. We can get later this single new person, and we can delete it. So it works very easy. But what's about N-to-M relation or many-to-many relations? In this case, we have a group that has zero, one, or more persons, and again, the person has zero, one, or more groups. We could use the same approach. For example, I put this array into my group, and here I identify the persons that are part of this group. Actually, there should be G1, sorry. And on the other side, in the person, I identify the groups that the person is part of. So, but now I have a problem. What's about caching? When I change this one, this could be still in the cache. So that works not very nice. And the other question is, which one of both is leading? Maybe I have to update both, but this wouldn't be an atomic operation when I have to change both. So it's a better way, of course, and this is done with subscriptions. So we create a separate resource. In this case, I call it membership. And this membership gets the person ID and the group ID, and then I can easily create, get, and delete this membership to add and remove a person to a group. Okay. So caching works because I have just one unique identifier for this resource. I can create, delete it with one call, so atomicity is working. And I even can put here additional properties which I couldn't do in the previous approach. At this example, I used already here and here and here prefixes. And I think this is a very good idea to use them for IDs. Agent 007, of course, it's readable, but maybe better is this one with a prefix. Or if you have a person and this has this cryptical ID, you can have a prefix to make it more readable. Again, I recommend using strict lowercase and hyphens. This is also done by Jira, which I'm sure you all know. They also have a prefix. In this case, it's not lowercase, but it's very handy this way, because you see to which project this ticket belongs. And it had also other advantages that I want to explain. Because this ID is a sequential ID. It starts with one and continues. If you create a new ticket, then we would get 517, 18, and so on. And this makes this UI guessable. In this case, it's an advantage, because we know when we see this UI that there are 515 other tickets. And we can use this information as to navigate to another ticket. Of course, you do this every day, I'm sure. So it's very practical, and the UI in our web browser gets part of the UI that we use every day. It's also hackable, because we can use it for navigation. We can replace the 516 with another number and go directly to the ticket. So, and this is possible through this proper UI design. I said this is an advantage, but there are other use cases where it's not. I invented this super cool app. It doesn't exist. It's just for this explanation. So we have our API of our super cool app, and there's a resource of users, and here's the UI of this very specific user. In this case, I guess that there are only 313 other users. And this is a disadvantage, because I started to use this API, which I thought is super cool, and then I'll see that there are only 314 other users. I thought there were millions. So it's obviously a disadvantage. And Hackable is in this case also a disadvantage, because I can go to other users' IDs. And this could be a potential security issue. Nonetheless, sometimes it's a good idea to work with sequential IDs, sometimes not. Nonetheless, never please use a one-to-one relation between your database key and your public ID. Even here, which looks actually like a sequential, like a database sequence, it's not. There's a difference. Okay. The next topic are Slug IDs. Stack Overflow, I'm sure you know it. Here's also a kind of resource called questions. And that is followed by an ID that identifies a single question. And this is the unique part of this UI. And this slug at the end, this trailing slug, is optional. And it is created by the question that the user has asked. And again, they follow, they use plural nouns, they use strict lowercase, and they use hyphens, which is very good. And this one is created by the title or the question the users ask, and now we can read and understand this resource before we go to that site and read it. So it's a kind of natural key, and it helps us to optimize our search experience, because when we see the results in our search, then we can decide if we want to go there or not. All right, that's all I have to say for UI design. The next topic I want to address are partial responses. The first technique that is well known is paging. If you have a list and you don't know how long it actually is, or it's just too much data to load it with one call, use paging. Yeah, you start. You say, get products, page one, count five. This is the maximum number of items you want to receive. And maybe you have some other properties that help to identify the correct order. And the second page is like the first, just here, page two. So it's very easy. As an alternative, you could use web linking, which is from the user experience, from the developer experience, a little bit more easier and handy. So in our array of links, we provide a link to the previous page, to the page that was currently loaded, which was page two in this case, to the next page. So we don't have to create this link by ourselves. We just use this link. But we could also go directly to the first page or the last one. So there are different things possible with web linking that support paging. But what's about streams of data? And usually we have streams of data. And this here I will show you that paging is not the best idea. Because again, we start reading the first page, page one, count five, and then we have written the messages from 6 to 10, which is what we have expected. But in the meantime, two other new messages have been added. If we now want to read the next five, this year, and we just say page two, count five, this won't work, because the subset that we want to read is computed from the very top. So we get 7 and 6 again. So it's not very good for data or list of data that changes quickly. As an alternative, you can use cursoring. When you start cursoring, just specify the amount of items you want to read. Let's say count 5 again, and this is indeed what we get. The messages from 6 to 10, in the meantime, two new messages are added. And then to read the next page, or the next, going down with our cursor to read these, we specify again count 5 and the max ID. The max ID is the lowest ID we had from this read, which here we have the ID 6, and 6 minus 1 is 5. If our client is not capable of computing this ID, we could provide a link. Or we could define the semantics differently. We could say it's the max ID is exclusive, then our client could use the smallest ID that he knows. But linking would be a better approach to help them cursoring through this stream of data. So we have now written the first 10 pages, but in the meantime, a lot of other messages have been added. How can we read them? Again, we can read with count 5 and start at the top. And to avoid reading the messages down here again, we specify a new parameter that is called SynceID 10 that says that we want to stop here. We don't want to read them again. So here we are. And finally, to read these, we use altogether count 5, SynceID 10, and max ID 13. And we only get exactly these three missing messages. So cursoring is a nice alternative for paging. Actually, it should be used every time. I don't see the advantage of paging. I would recommend using cursoring every time. There's another way for working with partial data or loading only a subset of the data that is part of an aggregate or an aggregate route, and this is embedding and linking. This small example is based on Siren. It's a hypermedia format. And this is not the complete Siren document. I just show you the two links that are important for this example. There's the self link that identifies this document itself, and there's another link called author that is a user-defined relation type. And this brings us to the author of this book. So this data is not included directly inside this document, but it is linked, and we can now go to the sub-entity and load it if it's necessary. This is a kind of lazy loading. We go and read this data only if it's really necessary, and it's not directly added into the document, which makes the document a lot more smaller. But my headline says embedding versus linking. It's also possible with Siren to embed the data directly, and this is shown here. Here's the link, but it's also embedded directly, so the client receives the data directly without an additional call. But this is very handy, but there's one disadvantage, because the client cannot decide if it's embedded or if it's just linked. The client has to work with both possibilities. And therefore, I would like to speak about GraphQL that helps selecting only specific fields of data that you want to have. GraphQL is not very helpful to build a RESTful API. Actually, when you use it, or many APIs that use this aren't RESTful, but actually it's very helpful. And let's have a look. Okay, GraphQL, that was originally developed by Facebook. And there is a reference implementation in JavaScript, and there are other open source implementations for Java and Python as well, and other languages maybe. And the whole idea is to create a query that is sent as a string to the server that supports this API. And this query expresses in detail which fields are required by the client. And based on this query, the representation is created and sent back. And all that is done with a strong type system that also supports introspection. Let's have a look at this first easy example. We want to have the author, Douglas Adams, so we create this shorthand query that has no name. And the only field we want to have is name. And then as a result, we just get this author with the name, nothing more, because this is the only thing we want to have. So it's possible to define a set of fields with ID, first name, last name. I can also use more complex data and nest these fields. And as I have shown before, it's also possible to use these user-defined functions. This function book ID and cover picture size and so on. This is part of the schema that is defined before. That is part of the API of GraphQL. Another helpful function of GraphQL are fragments. So you can externalize some definitions and reuse them again in a query. So this query is called book query. So this is just a name. And inside, I use this user-defined function book. And inside, I specify the fields I want to have with that fragment. And these three dots are actually an operator. This is this so-called spread operator to include fragments. So far, I've shown you examples to read data, but it's also possible to change data. And this is done with mutations. This mutations are sent with post, and the others to read data are sent with get. This mutation likes a book, which means the like count is increased by one. And I think it's self-explanatory what's happening. I identify the book 42, and then the like counter is incremented. And as a result, I get data back. And this is the book with name and like count. Okay, there are some other very interesting features, but before I want to explain them after this example that motivates and makes it more understandable. So what happens if our API changes? At the moment, we have this structure. We read our books 42, and this is the representation in JSON that has an ID, and title, and price. And now our business finds out that this price is not accurate enough and wants to have brutto and netto price. This is, of course, a breaking change because the older existing clients rely maybe on the field price, and this was removed. Therefore, it's better to leave it in and add the others. But this could also hurt existing clients because an old client might not be forward compatible. It might not can handle these unknowns because these are new and not known to existing clients. So therefore, we could use the GraphQL introspection API. And the client can create this query on this book. This query is called book introspection. This is just the name of my example. And you use a built-in function that's called type. And we want to have the type information of the type book. We want to have the name and some information about the fields. We want a list of fields. We want to include all deprecated ones with name, the information if it is deprecated or not, and a reason. And as a result, we get this. We get the type information of our book. Here's a list of or an array of fields. The first field is the ID that's not deprecated, but our price is deprecated. So this gives us a means for our clients to ask our API Which fields are new if there are new fields added if there are other fields that are deprecated. So this is a very nice way to inform our clients that something has changed. So an old client could continue using this query because he wants to have ID, title, and price, and nothing else. And the new client could use put a price because price is deprecated. Our server also knows by the requests that it receives which fields are actually required. And if there is no more client left that uses price, then we actually or eventually could remove this field without breaking any existing client. So it's very good for extensions that are compatible. And I would like to continue with this topic and talk about versioning, because this is done usually wrong. And I would like to start with the distinction, with the making a difference between data versioning and language versioning. Data versioning happens because a resource can have over time different states. Of course, the data can change. And regardless how often this data is changed, the meaning remains the same. So existing clients are not hurt by state changes. But then again, there are language changes. And when a language is changed or extended, the state remains the same, but the data is represented in a different way. And if you should use language versioning or language extension, as rule number one, try to make it backward and or forward compatible. Use version identifiers as a last resort to denote incompatible changes. So backward and forward compatibility is very important. Backward compatibility is, for instance, if our new USB port supports the older 2.0 sticks, then we can say this USB port is backward compatible. And there's also forward compatibility. This is the case when our old port supports even the new sticks. So this port is forward compatible. But you see, we can look at forward and backward compatibility from two perspectives. There's a perspective of the port and the stick, and the same is true for agents and origin servers. So, and to speak about, I have created this more summary and would like to speak about more about consumers and producers and their compatibility. A consumer could be backward compatible. This is the case when a new client receives a reply from an older server. Usually, the newer client looks up the version identifier and behaves appropriately. The version could be encoded in the MIME time or as a parameter of the MIME time. It could be encoded in the URL directly. But also directly inside the representation, when it's a XML document, we could use namespaces. On the server side, we can also support backward compatibility, and this is the case when a newer server gets a request from an old client. And usually we use replacement or side by side. Replacement means that our existing old server is completely replaced by a new one, and the new one speaks both languages, the old and the new API. Side by side means old and new server are deployed side by side. And maybe they use different MIME types or different URIs, and there's an API gateway in front of them, and the dispatching to the right server, the old or the new one, is done behind the scenes. It's also important to have version notifications because the existing clients have to be notified that there's a new version available. This is usually done out of band with emails, through documentation or newsletter. Sometimes links can be used, but often it's done out of band. What's about forward compatibility? If the consumer is, or the client is forward compatible, this is the case when an old client sends or receives, an old client receives a reply from a newer server. And if this is the case, this old client must accept unknowns. Remember this example with the price and the proto and netto price, an old client suddenly receives new fields and has to work with that. And these unknowns must be preserved. If there is, for instance, a long conversation between client and server, and there's a document that is sent back and forth between the client and server, of course, the client must not throw away the unknowns. It must be preserved. And necessary is also a version identifier substitution model that defines how the client interprets the given version identifier. Because there are different algorithms possible, the version identifier could mean that this is the latest version that the server supports, or it could be the minimal version that is necessary that supports all required features. So there are different semantics of identifiers. This must be clear. And finally, last but not least, the producer, the server, could also be forward compatible. And this is defined in the media spec. If there's an old server that has to accept requests from newer clients, then the API that this server implements has to define where and how these extension could happen. So there must be clear expectations defined. So if we build the server and we say future client can send extra data in this field or can use this extension bounds, then this is possible later for newer clients. And incompatibility is identified by checking the version identifier. And on the producer side, we can have side-by-side with both installation or a breaking replacement. So it's a very tough topic. That's why I have put also inside, or also added here these reference. When you have later a little bit more time, you can have a look at it. Error handling. I think I have some minutes.
10 minutes.
Okay. It's not much. Error handling is our last topic I want to speak about. It's very important to provide an API that is easily used, it has a good user experience, because from a user or developer's perspective, an API is just a black box. If something goes wrong and there's no meaningful, helpful reply, then our developer or our client does not know what has happened and how can he fix that. So a lot of time is wasted. And maybe he decides to go to another API that does this better. Common problems are usually tunneling even errors through 200 OK, or using for every problem 500 and saying internal server error and nothing more. So this is, both are not very helpful. Knowing that something went wrong does not help me. So there has to be additional information. HTTP provides a lot of status code. The interesting for us are the 400 and 500 codes for client and server errors. The most commons are this one. I'm sure you know them, but I want to say one thing about the 400. You can use this status code if, for instance, your JSON or your XML document that the client sends you is broken, it's not well-formed, you cannot parse it. Then it's a good idea to use 400 bad request because it's not well-formed, you cannot read it. If, however, the XML or the JSON is well-formed, but it's semantically wrong, then you could probably use 422, which says that the entity is not processable. this is an extension to HTTP, but it's more specific. So I recommend using 422 when it's maybe better than 400. 404 and 403, I think are well known. I don't have to explain it. On the server side, there's 500 as the general explanation that something went wrong. And 503 and 504 are often used. 504, this is maybe not known. Okay, this is when the gateway server or the web server that is used as gateway or as a proxy does not have a reply from the upstream server, then you can use 405. But anyway, what I want to tell you is if there's a problem and you use 500, that's not enough. You have to be more specific than this. And let's have a look how other APIs that are well known do this. Here's an example from the Twitter API. The Twitter APIs use an array of arrows. In this case, you have just one arrow inside, and it has a message and a code. And the message is for us developers and tells us what has happened. In this case, it says, sorry, that page does not exist. And there's a code that is intended more for machines, and we can look up in the documentation and see that it corresponds with HTTP 404, which is correct. And there's also an explanation of what was the reason. So it's a good idea to report the error with appropriate HTTP status code and, in addition, provide additional information with these kind of messages. This is also done by the Twilio API, and they do a little bit more than this. They have, of course, the message that reads no to number is specified, that this parameter is missing. There's a code, and then there's even a link. And this link can be used to find very fast, very handy, the explanation. So we go to this UI and see, here's our error, and here's even an explanation that helps us to avoid this error. So let's go back again. For helpful error messages, use the right status code, use additional proprietary error code to be more specific, to be more concentrated on your business problem. And if it's possible, provide a link into directly your documentation so that the user or developer finds help very quickly. Okay, and now we have time for some questions.